Hello, everybody, and welcome back to PGL Tavern Tales. My name is Nimsh, and I'm here with Raven and Life Coach to bring you another match, which is going to be the upper bracket final, Tessen versus JJ. But before we talk about it, Life Coach, how are you enjoying this tournament? How are you enjoying Bucharest?
Oh, very much, like always. I mean, it's now my third year in Bucharest, and the experience was always very, very good. Not only the tournament is awesome and everything, but Bucharest as well. So usually after the tournament, some friends, like the Hearthstone group, is usually going to get some dinner, some food, eating sushi. Talk about Hearthstone, of course, but also about life in general. So awesome every year, and this time the same.
And you basically just hang out with friends. This is what events are about, right?
Well, sure, but there are places where you can hang out better and where you can hang out a little bit worse, and Bucharest is on the top of the list for sure.
And would you, like, you personally, would you prefer invitational tournaments or the open tournaments where you have like more people, or do you want this like atmosphere with all the people you actually know from before?
Mm-hmm.
Like, personally.
Yeah, no, I think it's fine. I think it should always be a mix so that you have invitational, but also people who can qualify. But I like to have a specific rooster and everybody has to earn themselves a spot in the specific rooster. So nowadays we have, let's say, the top 20, 25 people who are getting invited into every tournament. And if somebody completely underperforms for a long time and somebody else out of the other thousands of people is performing very, very, very well, then yes, they can earn a spot in these 25. And this is also how it should be, because then you also see the same people over and over again, and I think it's also a pleasant experience for the watchers and viewers to know the people better.
Definitely. And Raven, what's your take on that? Like, yourself, are you enjoying more specific kind of events to cast them, to like participate in them, or is like whatever for you?
Yeah, I mean, the good thing at least about invitationals, or you know, predominantly invitationals like this event, is get to see a lot of the players that I see quite often, so it's nice to see them again, of course. But I'm just a big fan, like, sort of agree with Life Coach. I like a good mix as well. I think there's some events you look at, like some of the other DreamHacks that are like just big open tournaments where mm-hmm. you see a lot of the top end pros come and compete. But also, you know, you can just rock up if you want and, you know, give it a good go at the Swiss to see if you can get it through. But I think invitationals are a key for the, you know, continued growth of the game as well. So I just like to see a good mix overall.
All right. And this is an invitational, and we have JJ versus Tessen right now. JJ, he lost only to Tessen, and now he has to face him again. We actually had a chance to talk with JJ a bit before this match.
Playing against a teammate is never really a pleasure, but it happens. We practiced together, but he changed his strategy a little bit. He just banned a shaman over the druid. Like, my ban is always druid. I think that gave me a little bit of the edge, because I feel really confident with the druid, which also like gave me two wins in the series, which was pretty important. I mean, of course, it's never nice to like kick friends into a lower bracket, especially when it's your teammate, but it happens. And yeah, it still was a really good series and I enjoyed it a lot. I felt like the warrior mirror was really important. I'm very happy about my performance there. I think I played it really well. Where I traded into the Sylvanas, but made me really happy when I won the warrior mirror. I was a bit lucky against the Rogue with the top deck there, and then it was very one-sided because the Sue is very favored against the Hunter. I could have still lost, but it was very like 10% to lose the series there, very below average. But yeah, I think it was the Warrior Mirror which decided the series. I don't really care who I face nowadays, can be whoever. I prepared also with Stan for this tournament. He's like one of my main practice partners, so I don't mind facing him. It will be a good series. Like, at this stage, like, I'm also really, really happy that I came this far, of course. So yeah, I'm just waiting and seeing who I face, and will be excited.
I just want to clarify that JJ and Tessen are not teammates. This interview was actually made after he won versus Crane, so yep. He was explaining that match specifically. And what's interesting, he's actually, he was in the upper bracket and he was expecting to face Stansivka, where Crane was actually expecting to face Tessen. So like, at least both of them, they expected Stan to win, but Tessen was the one who was on top. Tessen is the only person in this tournament that's undefeated. He went undefeated through the group and he's still in the upper bracket. Life Coach, would you expect Tessen to do that well?
Well, I mean, I guess everybody here plays a very high skill level of Hearthstone, so I wouldn't be surprised about anybody going through the entire tournament and winning it, to be honest.
All right. And Raven, did Tessin impress you with anything specific over the last 2 days?
Yeah, I think it's just his overall confidence and approach to this kind of format as well, because the format's relatively new and a little bit different. And he's just always stayed very focused. Whenever I've spoke to him after before games, he's like, I know exactly what I want to do. I know exactly how it's going to play out in the picks and bans. Mm-hmm. So he's just got a very clear understanding of how the series will go before it even starts, or at least how he thinks it will go, and then actually executes it really well. He's been playing extremely steady throughout the whole tournament. Obviously, he's been continuing to win. There are a few matchups I know he doesn't like. He doesn't like playing against Freeze Mage or Freeze Mage Mirrors, for example. Mm-hmm. And we saw the same in the Anything Mirror when he played versus Sifka and struggled because some of the plays were a little bit off. And he fully admitted he just doesn't like playing the mirror and isn't very good at it. So, you know, other than that, I think he's played extremely solid. He has a lot of preparation. As soon as he's done with a match, he's already sorting out, you know, getting on with the next match. And yeah, it's a cool story overall. The winner will go into the winners' finals.
Yeah.
And then also, it's just kind of cool where Tessin's, you know, crashing through this tournament, and this is pretty much a big breakout performance for him if he can actually win the whole thing. It's very impressive with this kind of lineup in the whole tournament overall. But then you look at JJ, who's been like one of the most consistent players in Hearthstone this year, I think. Yep. He's just crushing every single tournament and at least placing well, like any taunt with Swiss. He just always qualifies through Swiss, just every single time. And then even through invitational formats similar to this, we saw he's just come off a win through Batstone as well. So proving he can do it no matter what. So this is a really cool match. I'm looking forward to it.
Yeah, absolutely. And actually, yesterday we were able to talk with Tessin after he won with Sansivka. Let's hear what he has to say about this match in the future.
I was really, really nervous before playing against Sixo and excited as well. I see him as the best player in the world, and he helped me prepare for the other matches today and yesterday, so yeah. But it went out, like, I won 3-0, so I'm really, really happy about that. Like, even though it's Hearthstone, it's a big achievement to beat the best player in the world, so I'm really happy. For sure, Sinfisky is a really hard opponent. He's a bit different from the other, like, he uses a lot of tech cards and played some different style, and it was really, really rough because the mind game was so hard. I had no idea what his game plan was, but it went out and I won the game 3-1. So I'm really happy about beating him. I feel a bit confident about it since I already won against him in this tournament, and I'm looking forward to play against him again and see if I need to use another strategy, if he's gonna use the same. And now we have open deck lists, so that's for sure gonna change my strategy. So I'm looking forward to play against him again.
So Tessin feels comfortable playing versus JJ again, but this is something I've mentioned before. Like, normally when you play Last Hero Standing or like Conquest with 3-4 decks, you can't really change your strategy that much. Maybe you have one ban, but here with 9 decks, you can actually have totally different lineup in the next match. So Life Coach, how does it influence this match? Like, do you think Tessin, because he won versus JJ, he will have that advantage, or will the experience that JJ has give him an advantage to change things up and have a different match versus Tessin?
Interesting. I mean, it also depends on the ban and ban phase and pick and ban phase. And I'm not exactly sure how many decks were being changed. I mean, I didn't watch the first series, so did they interchange all of the decks? Or
I'm not sure myself. Like, it was possible for them to change them, but maybe they will actually end up in the exactly same lineup.
Okay,
that would be interesting to see as well.
Like, yeah, I think the big difference as well is something Tessin touched on at the end of his interview, where he was like, well, when he beat JJ, it was hidden deck lists.
Okay, sure.
Yeah, because it was in group stage, so now it's not, and that changes everything, in my opinion. You can't, you know, even though Tessin's feeling confident, which is good, it's a different game when your opponent knows all your deck lists. So suddenly, you know, we can see the bans and picks coming up now.
First pick mage, that's something we haven't seen so far, I believe. We've seen Priest being first pick, we've seen Paladin, but this is mage, and this is Freeze Mage, I believe, from JJ. So that's a pretty interesting first pick. What do you guys think about it?
Yeah, I mean, in terms of what Tessin's been playing, he's been playing he's been playing a lot of the Paladin. He went 2-0 with Paladin versus Sifka, and I believe that a lot of the time Freeze Mage has at least a very clear way to beat the Anything Paladin if it's going to do it. So the first pick's going to look good there. But it is open up with the Warrior from Tessin, which I believe is Dragon Warrior.
Yeah.
So again, you know, not a great, you know, not terrible matchup at all. So I think the Freeze Mage is actually a really good pick. And Tessin said to me yesterday, something I mentioned earlier, that like that he doesn't really enjoy playing against Freeze Mage at all. And obviously JJ is a very competent player. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I'm surprised the Mage ban didn't come out to be honest, from Tessin, but we'll see if he gets punished by that.
Well, I'm not sure about the first pick freeze image, to be honest, because we also see that JJ at the same time also didn't ban Tessin's warrior, and Tessin first picked the warrior, and the warrior is obviously the value cannon against freeze mage, so I'm a little bit curious whether this first pick will really pay off, because I would have not been surprised if you would have maybe even gotten it as the second pick. But we can also just take a short look at the matchups and how they perform. So we have here the mage against warrior, which is a bad matchup. Against paladin is probably break even. Against shaman is break even. We have rogue against warrior, paladin, and shaman, probably 50-50 against everything too. And we have the hunter, which is probably break even against warrior. And again, shaman maybe a little bit favorite over the paladin. So I guess overall a very, very equalized series. Everything can happen.
This shaman is the midrange shaman, right? With the wicked witch doctor.
And yep.
Okay.
Yeah, I feel like the paladin might be a weak point in Tessin's lineup overall, because I feel like the hunter is just such an easy counter pick into the paladin, because it just we saw the opposite happen where Tessin picked hunter into Sivka's paladin and just absolutely crushed him. There's just always feels too much pressure from the hunter against Murloc paladin a lot of the time. So we'll see if that turns out. I feel like JJ will have a very clear plan going into this set, whereas Tessin's going to be more reactive.
Yes. Yeah, basically what you pointed out, that the Hunter is a very good deck against Paladin. I mean, it's not 70%, but it's in the area of 60.
It's a really strong. You would counterpick it into it, right?
Exactly. So I wouldn't be surprised if you see exactly this. Okay, so...
So Hunter versus Paladin is going to be the start of the match. Murloc Paladin, as we've seen, versus that Hunter with some new Karazhan cards. Kindly Grandmother being a really good card there as well.
Yeah, especially in this matchup. The benefit of Hunter is that the board is normally so annoying for the Paladin to have a clean clear. There's always just pressure and damage coming out consistently from the Hunter. And I think JJ is going to be feeling pretty good about the first picks here into the game one.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, we also already see the game plan with coining out 2-drop into 2-drop. I'm not sure when you want to have the Grandmother, though, because the Grandmother being deployed, if not being handled, only delivers 1 damage every turn. So it might be a consideration not to keep it. On the other hand, you can also just deploy her in a Doomsayer turn and then having a 3-2 after the turn.
Yeah, she also trades really well with the Loot Hoarders, and both Loot Hoarder and Doomsayer is in the hand. But the game starts right now, so have fun, guys, casting.
Thank you
very much, Glimsh. So yeah, basically what Glimsh also said, Grandmother can play into Murloc and can also play into the Loot Hoarder. So that's also what JJ has in mind, so deploying her.
Yep, it's looking pretty good for JJ so far. And the benefit as well is if you start piling the pressure on early, then a lot of the time, Murloc Paladin has very specific answers. And, you know, a lot of them require multiple cards to deal with. And, you know, putting pressure on this early means it's the earliest point in the game in which the Paladin probably doesn't have the exact answers they need.
Yes, and also the consistent face damage possibility, everything changes a lot. But yeah, I definitely agree, it's a lot about the tempo, especially about the first few turns. And yeah, if you can just shut off the Paladin in these few first turns, that usually pays off big time.
Yep, the Loot Hoarder are going to come down and actually contest the two minions, or you know, one of the two minions that's on the board now, that two attack being quite useful for Tessin here, but he does have a decent follow-up. He does have some of those answers. He has Consecrate to clear a wide board, True Silver to take down, if you know, something gets Houndmastered, for example. And then the Doomsayer, if he can feel he's comfortable enough to get a Doomsayer off, that either buys him more time or can actually potentially clear the board.
Exactly. I mean, we see that the horse wins over the wolf. But putting that aside, this is insane. The Loot Hoarder contested both minions, being a 2-1 against these 3-2. But not only that, but he also prevented 3 damage or healed for 3, because JJ was required to correctly trade into the 2-1, because otherwise he would have gotten consecrated. I'm not even sure whether that was perfectly correct, because he missed out 3 damage, and that is only if a consecration comes down. And even then, the Toad might have also hit the Loot Hoarder. So in average, he forfeited 6 life for the possible Loot Hoarder on the board.
And also as well, unless, like you said, the Consecrate happens, which would be worst case scenario, the Toad might kill it. But if the Consecrate isn't there, the Loot Hoarder is always going to be traded, right?
Exactly.
There's not a world in which Tessin ignores the board and goes face with Loot Hoarder. So you kind of want... It's really good to put your opponent in the position where you gain the extra damage because you know he's going to trade into you because he's on the defensive.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Yeah,
so
exactly,
it's basically 3 damage for free. Unless there is a consecration, even if there is a consecration, it can still be hit. And even if not, well, then you traded 3 life against a 2-1 on board. Might not matter that much anyways.
We see JJ now continuing to pile on the pressure. Already 20 health for Tessin and a couple of really awkward minions to deal with. He can clear off the Elec with the True Silver, but It looks a little bit awkward. I think this is this a turn you feel like a Doomsayer needs to come down?
Here, I don't know, Kim.
Just to buy yourself some time. If you can, you can kill off the Elec easily with the weapon, take a bit of damage, but heal back up for two with the True Silver. But then I feel like because your follow-up doesn't feel great, it almost forces a Doomsayer.
Yeah, maybe you
can. And we can see it's going to be very effective because there's two Stranglethorn Tigers in JJ's hand. I like this play.
You also like the Pyro?
Yeah, I think so, because you just create the awkward point of, well, if you can deal with the Doomsayer, then the Pyro's still there to start trading.
Okay. Interesting, because, I mean, what if here JJ decides to just leave it be? Then he would have basically skipped, then he would basically skip the turn.
Yeah, which is like the benefit.
Which is what he does, right? So in this case, 3-2 would trade against 4-3, so Doomsayer was basically 2 mana. Skip your opponent 5.
Yeah,
sounds good. Sounds great, and also
especially with the hand that Tessin has, right? If he's just forced the skip turn there, then the forbidden healing skip turn this turn might feel a little bit easier, you know, to really manage. It might not necessarily be the forbidden healing this turn, as he does have True Silver, but because you in this matchup you really need True Silver to trade and not just go face. So it's kind of an awkward one. Nothing feels too great this turn.
Yeah, probably Acolyte. That's fine. I was just wondering about the Pyro, because if you draw a quality later, maybe also with the Consecration, you have this hidden 3 damage potential. Mm. Also, you have this hidden 1 damage potential if you play it into Forbidden Healing. So there were also some reasons to not play him, but I agree. Yeah. Tempo-wise, it's definitely...
Yeah, I think the worry is you might not get to the point where you draw the equality without, you know, some kind of board presence.
Exactly.
Or at least to challenge it.
Exactly.
And now with Kill Command and Quickshot in hand, you know, there's a decent sum of burst available. And we see now it's actually not going to be a high maintain. In fact, go for the Stranglethorn, which is much more difficult to interact with because it does have stealth. So pretty much, if you want to kill it this turn, requires the equality.
I'm not even sure about... Oh, wow. Okay. So, but he has 2 Forbidden Healing, so yeah, why not? And he got the Wall Eater.
Yeah, not too bad.
And yeah, he correctly heals. But I was wondering, the Acolyte turn, I mean, he could have also equipped the True Silver, that was definitely also a close order. It was also Call of the Wild. That's
so much damage available.
It's a lot of pressure. So now he has access to 15 damage.
How much do you like just going face with the Tiger, playing the second Tiger, and weaving in hero power this turn? Because if you didn't, if you didn't really deal with this Tiger on like a relatively low health, the odds on the equality is getting is still quite low.
No, I like it very much because you can follow it up by Kill Command, Quick Shot, Hero Power, or by
depending on what's going on. So I really like this play, and weaving in the Hero Power is always nice, right? Just that little extra bit of pressure.
Oh yes, it is. I mean, Light Lord will be also quite strong. Is it enough, the Light Lord? 18, yeah, should be enough. Yeah, so Light Lord will definitely come down here, I'm pretty sure, and the trades will happen. Mm-hmm. What would you trade?
I think you might need the cycle.
Yeah?
Because there's no way any time soon that Acolyte's going to get more than one card anyway.
No, I would probably. I mean, you're committed to play Light or Tier, so I would just trade the other 3 and leave Acolyte alive. Because I mean, you can also send it into Leoc, maybe. So there are possible options, right? But what about Light Lord? Light Lord is also pretty nasty for JJ, right? I mean, he needs to handle it somewhat. It has kind of taunt.
I mean, he could just quit, like, because he's got so much damage potential with Call the Wild, Kill Command, and Quickshot. He could always just Quickshot the Light Lord for the 50-50. And build up into the Call the Wild next turn to kill. I suppose you rely on the Light Lord trading anyway, right? The Light Lord's more than likely going to trade into the Tiger anyway.
What I'm simply saying is that the Light Lord delivers 16. Oh, that's sick. What I'm simply saying is that the Light Lord, if Call of the Wild comes down now, it's super awkward.
Yeah.
The Light Lord, I mean, you cannot really commit anything into it. So, I mean, what do you do about the Light Lord? Seriously, it's super tough, right? I mean, you don't want to play Kill Command Quickshot on it. You don't want to high main and Quickshot and send your Tiger into it. So, what do you do about him? Probably you Kill Command Quickshot it, right? That's the only way. Kill Command Quickshot, the Light Lord, Fiery Bat, and Tier Power. It's the only thing you can do here, I guess.
Yeah, I'm wondering if there's a way you can think you can just overpower the Light Lord and just the 8 healing will not be good enough. Looks like JJ's gone for the Call of the Wild. I think I would have looked at High Main, Quickshot, Light Lord for the awkward trade onto the High Main. Because then the Light Lord wouldn't have been able to trade with the Tiger or the High Main because it dies.
No, but this is super awkward. You cannot do that. You cannot overcommit against Paladin and then the Paladin gets healed for 8 every turn. You cannot do that. No way. I mean,
he still has a second call in the wild, though. So the board needs to be cleared because it's going to be so much damage.
Maybe
there needs to be so there'll be the 8 from the Light Lord, which bear in mind, like, can heal itself if it trades, and it's always going to trade.
No, but look, there's a blue gen into the Misha. That's already
yeah, that's pretty sick. The Wall Leader staying alive is kind of huge.
Right, and then there are. I mean, what's the best way to do it? You can probably even draw. So let's see. If she played. Nah, do you want to play Consecration? If he plays Consecration, he can Solemn Vigil for 2, but then he can play anything else.
I think he can do the trade, Solemn Vigil for 1 and play Doomsay potentially. The problem here is, like, he just needs the Light Lord to hit face.
No, that's true.
Ooh, okay. I mean, that's a way to do it, I guess.
Yeah.
Use the Forbidden Healing on the Light Lord and like I said, guarantee the hit on face here.
Okay. Was that the best way to do it? I don't know. It felt felt a little bit strange. Did you feel that was the best way to end it?
It's definitely not what I was looking at, to be honest. The Forbidden Healing is so powerful if you can get the full 10 off, or even close to 8. But I suppose keeping the rag, guaranteeing the health, there's no better way you could guarantee the rag to hit yourself, and it also guarantees the rag can continue to trade and not be cleared up very easily by the hunter.
Okay, so look at this. So what he did is he played Consecration and killed Huffer, left Leok alive. He could have also played True Sever, kill Leok, with the same effect, but having a True Sever online, right?
Yeah.
So he would have not been able to kill
the Huffer,
yeah. Yep. But that's... I think that's okay if you have a True Sever charge for
that. Yeah. And the extra damage is gained after the Call of the Wild anyway.
Exactly. Yeah.
Okay, so is Ivory Knight the only opportunity Tessin's got here to draw into something that's going to keep him alive? Because he's running out of ways to heal this Ragnaros up to 4 to guarantee the 8 from Rag, so...
Yeah, I mean, the Consecration would be pretty handy now.
It would be pretty nice. I suppose, though, the Leok wouldn't be on 2, right? Oh, the Leok would be dead because the Hoof would be alive. Oh, yeah.
True Sever would be even better. True Sever would be online.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah.
Okay, this is kind of awkward. I'm surprised we're not seeing the Ivory Knight first.
Yeah, he wants to probably Solemn Vigil, right? If I see it right.
Yeah, I guess. It's just that we. He's all in on Rag Heal on his face. That's the difference. Like, Ivory Knight at least can give you, you know, a potential 10 heal, maybe.
Right.
But now he's just all in on Rag Heal in face.
Well, and even then, it's not enough.
Yeah, he's still in trouble.
Yeah.
And it hits himself, and that is going to be the game as Super JJ takes the first one with his Hunter. And like we said right at the beginning, got starting off Hunter into Murloc Paladin, JJ going to be feeling pretty happy about that matchup, and it went his way.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I mean, definitely worked out. Also, the risky play when he ignored Ragnaros the Light Lord, I mean, in hindsight, it's definitely worked out. So I was feeling, okay, maybe if you just ignore the Light Lord and he does have any way to handle your board at least half decently, Paladin just gets 8 heal every turn for free, and usually you cannot let this happen. But yeah, it turned out that...
I think with JJ's hand, because he had Kill Command, Quick Shot, and Call, it meant that he just went in on the, I'm just going to out-heal this, because Rag is going to have to start trading, and the second Rag misses and heals itself or another minion, then he just wins, because he's just got so much power available to him. But we are in the next game. It's going to be Tessin going into his Shaman versus Super JJ's Hunter, and didn't look like a too bad opening hand from Tessin, I don't think. I did see a Tunnel Trog, which always feels good. Okay, nothing too crazy.
Okay, so
Feral Spirit helps. Yeah.
So we see the Tessin actually picked the Shaman into the Hunter, which is usually supposed to be a positive matchup, especially because we also know that Super JJ's Hunter is a Camel Hunter, and as such is very, very vulnerable against Shaman. Well, sure, I mean, Camels are simply dead cards, and injured Cavaliers as standalones, I heard that's also not the burner. So yeah, let's see how it goes.
It's definitely not when you want to draw into at this point in the game at all. And the coin, Feral Spirit, looking pretty nice. It's looking very awkward for JJ to deal with. He does have the bow, so he can clear off the 2 Feral Spirits this turn, and then at worst have the charge, unless another taunt appears, but there's not really going to be any mana available to do anything for Tessa next turn. So JJ going to take a bit of damage, but at least he knows he can deal with the tunnel truck and follow up and, you know, have the priority. You don't expect too much from one mana.
Right, it does look pretty good, right? I mean, now...
Oh, double toad.
Nice. Yeah, it's really good. It just creates the pressure, and usually Shaman wins by against Hunter by being ahead. But, well, now Shaman simply isn't, so...
Mm-hmm. I do know as well, Tessen plays four AoEs in this deck. So there is a chance that he can actually, you know, swing the board back in his favor if he loses control of it. But we don't see any of those AoEs quite yet. He did go for Barnes and just get a 1-1. Nothing too crazy. Right.
But that's a really, really bad turn for JJ here. So he had the injured Cavalier, which is obviously not a genuine drop. And now he's forced to play two cards, which are both 1-drops and Hero Power, which he doesn't want if the Shaman is at 30, and float 1 mana. Mm. That's horrible in all aspects, really. Yeah. And then the Barnes, of course. I mean, he cannot really... I don't even know, that makes sense. But now he's really gambling on this one. Oh yes. Ooh, this is sick. This is
the problem. The problem with this turn is Maelstrom Portal just ruins his day.
Yes.
It's just very cheap, no overload on it, and just clears the whole board. Takes 2 damage from the death rattles, but who cares? The one drop might soak that up anyway.
Yeah, but there is no Maelstrom Portal, so that's also very convenient.
It's very fortunate for JJ that there's no clear here.
Well, extremely, yeah. First of all, that there is no clear, and second of all, the 1 damage, of course, hit the 3-4.
Yeah.
Both, all very convenient things. And Tessen plays the dragon to... I mean, he knows that he plays 4 AoE effects in his deck, and he's just wondering, well, where they are. And that's the reason why he tries to draw as quickly as possible. And yeah, definitely the right thing to do.
Now JJ has won the fight for the board early on, at least, and that high main is a bit of a problem with no Hex Insight either. It's going to be a little bit rough for Tessen to try and deal with.
Yeah, Totem Golems are always appreciated, but no.
Always.
Yeah.
You never say no to a free Totem Golem,
no,
I've heard.
Definitely no. Yeah. That's for sure. I mean, the Swing from Below also costing 6 mana at the beginning of the turn is also a very rare thing to witness. So here we go, yeah, sure.
Yeah, 2 goes at it. Not too bad, 50 chance.
I would have been really, really surprised if you wouldn't have seen at least 1 Totem Golem, if not 2.
Yeah, sometimes it feels like it isn't an even chance for each Totem to come out of Tuskar.
Yeah.
Always feels like Totem Golem's favoured somehow.
And Mana Tides.
Yes, true. Anything that's not a normal Totem.
Yes, yes, exactly. And of course, Spell Power if they need it.
May as well just be choose the Totem. At this point, so the
which Jessica does, so 3 Jessica basically.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, just a card plus another minion, and you do it for 3 mana instead of 6. Fantastic. So the Ellie came down, and it was not going to win a joust with the grandmother there, but Infested Wolf just continuing to put some pressure on the board. And now, how do you think JJ is going to approach this board? Is he going to try and clear or pile on more pressure?
Well, I guess he clears the Totem Golem with a high main. The Toad goes on a 3-2. Stuff like this. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Makes a lot of sense. Yeah, it's reasonable. On the other hand, if the 1 damage...
That happens, it sucks.
No, but also in general, the 1 damage shouldn't matter. But
The Hex, though. It's going to be really nice to clear off this high main.
There's still no AoE and we see JJ having a Call of the Wild. It's interesting what you mentioned with the trades, because it's not even written in stone that he should do the trades, given that his hand size is only containing out of 1 card. So the thing is, if JJ doesn't draw anything else the next 1 or 2 turns, he will just run out of cards, and then Shaman will win for sure.
You could have took the approach where your very clear plan for the rest of the game is to go face Call of the Wild and rely on hero power and on what you get off the top in terms of burn. So
exactly.
There was definitely an option to do that, but we see now Tessen's actually took a bit more control of the board even without an AoE.
No, that's sick. The quick shot is really sick. That's exactly when you want
that's
him.
That's literally
so.
The card you wanted to draw.
But yeah, so JJ still has to do this trade at least. But still no AoE, it's really silly. Oh, he really trades? Oh, that would... Yeah, okay, because he's afraid of AoE. It makes sense. Makes sense. But he cannot overtrade. I mean, he really doesn't have that many cards in his hand left, so he should not overtrade, because once he runs out of cards, the game is over in the favor of Shaman.
Yeah,
so
especially because we can see Tessen has the Mana Tide available in hand for whenever he feels he needs to start, you know, continuing to cycle through his deck. And the Azure Drake as well, so not really necessarily going to need them this turn, but, you know, Tessen has cycle, whereas JJ is kind of all in on this quick shot, getting some work done.
Right. So you now Totem up, I guess? Yeah. Totem up and Thing from Below. Yeah. Makes a lot of sense.
Yeah, really nice turn. It's really nice when you see the Call of the Wild come out, and then you can just not answer it fully, but present an even more of a board. And there's Nuzzot.
There is Nuzzot.
So
what did die? What
2
did
toads,
die?
A bat, a high main.
No,
high main
got
hexed. High main got hexed, yeah. And the wolf, if it dies, which you would make it die this turn. Even if you wanted to save it for some reason beforehand, you would probably trade it off this turn now because you have the Nazoth right on time.
This is so sick. I mean, on the other hand,
it's a dead turn, this turn.
Exactly, yeah, it locks your turn. So, is Nazoth really worth two turns? That's really the question. I don't even know about that. I mean, two turns is very, very costly. You cannot just skip two turns, right? Not doing effectively.
Yeah. But this is looking pretty reasonable because now the idea for JJ now, especially with this Nazoth, what he might want to happen is Tessen commits to clearing this board, and he's like, okay, you've used what AoE you may or may not have had or may or may not draw into. There we go. You know, like if there was a Maelstrom portal drawn, I imagine it probably now.
What's correct? Yeah, probably.
Yeah.
Maybe. I mean, yeah, but probably.
I think so.
Yes.
The Leo could get too much value with the second Call of the Wild as well.
I like it. The second. Yeah.
If there was a second call.
Yeah, sure.
Oh, and that's Hymen.
Oh, now he is.
now we stop and think, is a second Hymen from Nazoth potentially worth it versus just slamming Nazoth now?
And that goes against Tempo because he's already at 19. So he might really answer the question. I mean, he's facing 8 damage on board. So might as well that you just see Nazoth coming down here. I mean, he already got a lot of... is he filling the board, by the way? No. Yes, he is. Did he miss?
I think that's exactly right.
That's exactly what he got, right?
Because the Hymen got hexed.
Yeah.
And he also could have made space if he really wanted and just trade the spider in, so...
Yeah, that was my question. Yeah. Whether...
Yeah. I think I like this because high main, and you're probably going to be able to play the next card you draw as well.
Oh, sick. Okay, this is so sick.
To be fair, this looks like, you know, very fortunate, and it is, but also Tessen has four AoE in his deck, and he hasn't drawn any yet. So, no. You know, Lightning Storm, pretty reasonable.
But he shouldn't do it. Okay. So, he shouldn't do it now. He should...
trade the 1-1 first.
Right? I think so, because of the toads, which can deliver the damage on it. But this is sick, because the wolf also dies for free. And this is sick. He doesn't even duplicate the wolf.
Yeah,
and this
is just... spell power guaranteeing the kill as well.
Oh, well, it actually duplicated. Never mind. I'm talking nonsense. Okay. I was, yeah.
Oh, because everything dies first.
Yeah, that was nonsense. It was another interaction.
It's fine.
With Imking boss, I think.
Yeah, because it's Death Rattle versus a token generation.
Yeah, exactly. Never mind.
Okay, so this is the point we were talking about earlier, where the mana tides are now going to start helping Tessen just stay in the game due to card advantage more than anything. He does get the Kvaldir, though. Not bad for JJ, and there's no one drops left for Tessen, so kind of got away with that one. And a follow-up with Hymen. Pretty good turn, considering you've just been completely blown out by Lightning Storm.
Yes, definitely that, but it's still looking very bad for JJ. Putting that aside, it's interesting talking about also the turn where JJ had the decision between playing Nazoth and the Hymen. And it's funny, right? In hindsight, the Hymen would have been way, way better.
Mm-hmm.
But okay, I mean, who...
Especially because more than likely, if the Hymen was traded into, the Lightning Storm could have been used to kill off the tokens that were left after.
Yeah, exactly. So... I'm not exactly sure whether I agree with it, especially because JJ didn't see any AoE effects at this very moment. So I think after playing Nazoth, he can actually assume that he can actually assume such a thing, right? That his entire board will get blown out. On the other hand, if he plays Hymen first, he already has a nice threat on board, and if he plays then Nazoth, then he also gets a Hymen, which would have been insane value.
Yeah,
exactly.
And JJ is gonna have to trade here because he's just dead. Otherwise, so you know, it's normally a reasonable request to trade there. And the Stranglethorn Tiger is actually a really nice draw because it's like immune to almost anything that Shaman can do now.
He just chose to kill the. That's interesting, I feel, because he just chose to sacrifice his Kvaldir in order to kill the 4-2 dragon over the 2-2 mana tide totem. I'm not sure whether I agree with this, because the mana tide is pretty important, I feel.
It also removed the spell power for the weapon, though, as well. So it removed the additional +2 damage on the weapon. So maybe it's just scared of the amount of damage that could come out.
No, sure it does, but the mana tide totem draws you one card every turn, so...
Yeah, I mean, this, he's just going to lose in a couple of turns due to having no cards, right? So this could be what... This could put him to 1 if it was Huffer. It isn't, it's Leok. So always Leok when you don't want him.
But at 6, even in this position, a kill command would have been lethal. So it looks completely lost for JJ, but even so, I mean, it's now it's actually very, very close. A Huffer would have already done it, so... Is it lethal? Yeah, it is.
Yeah, with the Thunderbluff, it is. I was just sat counting the flame tongue anyway, so I think Flame Tongue rolling into Spell Power and then Lightning Bolt was lethal anyway.
No, it would have been lethal anyways, I think, even without rolling anything.
Oh, right. Oh, sure. Yeah.
Or is it? No, I'm not sure. But like,
it doesn't matter.
Yeah, it doesn't.
It doesn't matter. So, you know, testing that was really close actually. Even with the Lightning Storm coming out at that point,
it was
huge.
It
just changed
so sick.
The game, yeah.
Also the Nezzot, I mean, especially that JJ had so many empty turns. Like when he had this turn 5 empty, turn 9. How can a turn 9 be empty? I mean, you draw a quick shot.
The excitement of having Nezzot for turn 10, but then going, oh, my whole turn is quick shot hero power. Like for turn 9
it's
mana.
It's crazy, especially because any other draw would have also been, would have enabled the quick shot into another card draw. So, yeah. And the Nezzot in the end, it didn't do anything, right?
Yeah.
I mean, it just got Lightning Stormed. So the Nezzot was not even that good. It was very interesting. Okay, now we get to the skill heavy matchups. Yeah, freeze mage against shaman, so very skill intense for the freeze mage player for sure.
Yeah, and you know, just to let you guys know, Tessin is 1-1 with JJ. The overlay just hasn't been updated yet, so it's going to be the shaman versus the freeze mage. So what is the freeze mage going to do here to win this game?
Okay, so Freeze Mage plan is basically to, well, like always, right? I mean, Freeze Mage things.
It's always the same plan.
It's always the same plan. I guess against Phase Shaman, you might have had the game plan also to exhaust your opponent out of resources, but that will never happen against the mid-range shaman. So against the mid-range shaman, it's really just a tempo plan. You just try to get ahead in tempo, maybe even dealing, there are two plans. One plan is maybe dealing some damage in the early game so that the shaman ends up being at 20 life or something, and then you can burst him right away. That would be the most convenient thing. And the other game plan obviously involves Alexstrasza, which JJ doesn't have in the hand yet. So that's the thing, right? I mean, if Alexstrasza is, let's say, in the bottom 5 cards, well, JJ will probably just lose the game. So that's the thing about Freeze Mage.
I think with Freeze Mage, if you don't have Alexstrasza, you can't really play as if you're going to draw it. Because the time you don't draw it, you can't really set it up that hard. So you have to just, until it's in your hand, you go with the plan of, like you said, doing some damage and getting to 20.
Hey, this feels so bad.
I thank you
this
as well.
This feels so bad. Look at JJ face. JJ face is like, yeah, I know what that is. Yeah, I know exactly what you're doing, bro. Yeah. He's not even surprised. He's like, yeah, okay, things like you.
That's what Tuskar does, right? Does he not say summon Manatide, Flame Tongue, or Tongue?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
I thought that was the card text.
That's ridiculous, especially because Manatide is so freakingly strong against Freeze Mage. This Manatide, I don't know about it, but I bet that this Manatide will probably draw 3 or 4 cards at least.
It's so awkward to deal with as well.
It's crazy. It's just crazy. And that also enables you automatically this Dispel Power. So while usually Tessin has a deck with 4 AoE, which are pretty much dead cards against Freeze Mage, well, if you have a Mana Tide Totem, yes, you draw your AoE and you also draw your other card, and it's a flame. This is so sick. And JJ is like, yeah, okay.
Tessin's nodding, JJ is just like, yep, this is happening to me. I mean, JJ does have freeze effects available to him next turn. He can play Frost Nova and then sort of try and, you know, last into a Blizzard. Mm-hmm. But again, the frustration is that Blizzard doesn't deal with the 3 health minion of the Manatide and the Flame Tongue. So they're going to need to be, you know, maybe some damage weaved in at some point.
This is just crazy.
Is there ever merit to Frost Nova Ice Lance to clear off something here? Well, is there ever a point, because Blizzard doesn't clear up the Manatide, for example?
Well, you need the things, right? I mean, it's not that you can just throw around with Ice Lances here and there. You need the damage. So it's I think at this very point, it will become very, very difficult for JJ to... I mean, now he needs to use Ice Lance, but for what? I mean, he still takes a lot of damage. So we have other Spirit Claws. Spirit Claws are also... these are like small Doom Hammers, right?
Yeah.
So... probably Tessin should also begin to do that, because he will probably be freezed and the damage on board is sufficient. So probably just deploying the Spell Power and then hitting every turn.
Yeah, because you've got the second one, the 1 mana investment into re-equipping it is almost nothing at this point, considering the amount of damage you can get out.
Yeah, I don't know about the Sun of Love. It might be okay. Because he now forces JJ to freeze every turn. I don't like nuclear attacking with his Spirit Claws. I would have definitely attacked with them. But it's, I mean, now you force JJ to freeze every turn, but I think he would have been forced to freeze every turn anyways. I mean, if you take a look at the
board, the Flame Tongue kind of just does that anyway, right?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. So the damage on board was already 11. If you have played the Lightning board with the Tunnel Truck, it's 12. With the Blood Mage, it's 13. There's no way that Freeze Mage can simply take 13 damage every turn. So I feel it would have been a better bet to just try to force the damage in other ways. Mm-hmm. For example, with this Claws for 3, with the Lightning board, maybe for 4 if you roll the Spell Totem. But yeah, I mean, let's see. Let's see how it goes. But yeah, JJ is now in a very awkward spot because now he needs to freeze every freaking turn and from this point, so that's really tricky.
He's already got two turns worth of freeze available at this moment in time. He does have the Frost Nova with the follow-up from the Blizzard, but still, it's not looking too great. I'm going to go for the Novice Engineer to try and draw into something that's going to help him out. Second Torch. I mean, he's piecing together a lot of damage, but it's whether he can even survive to make it worthwhile.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, it's also that you can not use your damage in one turn. And because you need to freeze. Yeah, exactly. You need to survive every turn. And it's also not that you can burn the Phase Shaman down from 28. It's just not possible. Yeah. I mean, damage-wise, we see 3, 7, 13, 16, 19 damage. So it's close, but he will never have the time to do that.
Yeah.
So, yeah, now I'm very curious what will happen.
This Manatide.
It's
still
pretty
drawing
pretty
cards.
Silly.
Look at the size of the hand.
Yeah, Claw Face, okay.
Sure. Yep, start using that damage, why not?
Makes a lot of sense, another card.
Yeah, why not? Just keep them coming. Just continue with all the card draw, giving Tessin as many options as possible to continue the onslaught onto Super JJ here. And not too much of a surprise the Blizzard's coming down. You can even use the Engineer now to take off one of these minions. And what do you value here? Has the Manatide got to the point where you don't care anymore because it's drawn so many cards, so you kill the Flame Tongue?
No, I wouldn't kill them. I would kill the Manatide, but okay. It's close because if you kill the Flame Tongue, your 1-1 survives. So I guess it doesn't really matter that much. But I mean, one card is one card, right? So
yeah.
It's 3-14. Yeah, probably the first time where JJ doesn't freeze Tessin, he will. I mean, the thing is, usually you would also need to see whether you overcommit or not. But having drawn that many cards and knowing that JJ doesn't play Flame Tongues, it really doesn't matter. He can just play everything. Mm-hmm. Just everything on the board. Yeah, this totem, Sink from Below. Just commit everything. It's perfectly fine.
Yeah, I mean, you have enough cards to just refill anyway, right? Yeah, Worst case scenario, if the whole board gets wiped somehow, you can just go, okay. Do it again. Just refill. So.
Yeah, exactly. Just string from below, draw another card. Yeah. And the first time JJ cannot handle the board, I would really not see any way how JJ can fight against these 5-6 additional extra cards from the Shaman.
There's Alexstrasza, but two turns away for a start, and we've seen like no ice barriers either. So there's nothing that's really, you know, helped JJ survive in terms of his health other than freezing the board every turn. It's going to ping the Acolyte. Speak of the devil.
Yeah.
The ice barrier is going to get drawn, but it's not going to be enough. And JJ loses the next game against Tessin Shaman and losing with a freeze mage, so kind of rough.
Yeah, that's really, really rough. Yeah. I mean, yeah, Tuska into Manatide, Tuska into Flame Tongue. Yeah, that's
pretty powerful.
That's pretty powerful. That's pretty powerful. I mean, we see JJ here already near Monster Tilt. At least he looks a little bit like this. And of course, it's very difficult, right? I mean, he picked the Freeze Mage, and I believe that the Freeze Mage is actually favorite against the slow Shaman, slow mid-range Shaman with these totemic mites, or also with these four AoEs. And he really believed that this deck would have at least a 60-65% against it.
Yeah, well, the problem there was it's great versus the slower Shaman list, but the Shaman didn't go slow, did it? It went super fast, and you're like, oh, okay, well, yeah, you know, I guess I lose. But how do you feel like JJ's chances are with this Rogue?
Well, I guess it's decent. I mean, Rogue against Shaman, yeah, I would say 50-50. I really don't see. I mean, the AoE doesn't help that tremendously against Rogue. Rogue is not in a class which is vulnerable to AoE, so that shouldn't matter. The Rogue of JJ plays double conceal, and that might be important against, sometimes against direct damage. So if JJ can set up minions, conceal them, and then go for phase in two turns, that could be able to do that. I guess it depends a lot about the tempo, so how fast Shaman is, how fast Rogue is, and whoever comes up ahead from the early game will probably win the game.
Yeah, we see the Tome Gong coming down from Tessin, and it is vulnerable to a backstab into Hero Power or Trade, if you really want. You can probably afford to take the 3 damage now, though. Also just has Shadow Strike, but especially in this deck, there's a lot of better targets for Shadow Strike later on, I believe, than just the Tome Gong. Unless he's going to go for it.
Shadow Strike, interesting.
There are so many other minions that Shadow Strike's great on when you already have like another answer.
Yeah, so what would you do?
I think I'd just go for backstep.
And dagger up, right?
Yeah. You can take the 3 damage now, like it's fine.
Well, I would to be honest, I would also put the cold blood. You don't like
it? Yeah, why not? You have the mana actually.
Yeah.
Yeah, sure.
has to be Lightning Bolt or Maelstrom. Yeah, he does it.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, there is a Maelstrom because it aligns perfectly into this 2 mana. So it was really about the Maelstrom. Because if it's not Maelstrom, it takes Lightning Bolt, which would be insanely huge. But Maelstrom is not huge at all. Maelstrom is trading super beneficially here. So also perfectly aligning into curve and everything. So the Maelstrom is just sick.
Yeah, let's see what one drop is going to come up with. Some pretty strong ones. Also that's a strong one.
That's a strong one. Sure. I mean,
it's no Injured Kvalde, but it's strong.
Here,
but
no.
It's very good still.
Well, especially in Shaman, right? If you have access to Flame Tongs, it just does the job. I mean, it's better than Squire. Right?
It gets the work done, and now there's a Tomb Pillager staring the face of that Possessed Villager. I think there's still plenty of options here, though, for Tessin.
Yeah, Tessin has no access to Azure Drake, Lightning Bolt yet. But yeah, he might do something like Mana Tide and Lightning Bolt. And this, I actually like this very much, because not only do you convert your villager into a new minion, which Rogue has to handle again, but he also has this Mana Tide, which now has to be handled by direct damage. So this Mana Tide will eat 3 direct damage, and that's a very strong and very good play.
Yeah, and also with one charge of the weapon, that's just even better, right? Because you know there's going to be no easy deadly poison kill, and then I've got the second charge left. And if it forces JJ to re-dagger and do it, then that's just yet another victory for Tessin.
Yeah, and this looks very much like another victory, because this Mana Tide is doing some serious work. I mean, just look at this. What are JJ's options? I mean, all of those are really bad. Yes, dagger up,
there you go, that's the weapon,
deadly poison. Also utilizing the coin, being forced to utilize the coin into SI7 agent on the 1-1 is also not beneficial. He doesn't like to do that, but he... Oh, wait.
He's not going
to
go for it.
Oh, wow.
It's kind of interesting because, again, now the dagger has the poison. You don't want to run it into the 1-1. And the so SI feels like the more natural option to just clear it up and put a minion on board.
I have no clue why he didn't do that.
Yeah, there's no gadgets on either, so it's not like you know you're trying to hold the coin to help cycle going forward. It's going to be Shadow Strike into SI, so it worked out fine in the long run. Gave him a pretty decent turn this time. Didn't have to use the dagger at all then.
And what I'm saying is he needs the pressure, right? I mean, if he just, if he plays the value game, it won't come as a surprise that the mid-range Shaman will simply go ahead. So I'm a little bit surprised of seeing JJ not playing the 3-3 the turn before. But yeah, we will see how this will turn out.
Getting the spell power totem is kind of nice there. It means you can utilize the Spirit Claws instead of having to, you know, feel like he needs to Lightning Bolt. 3-3 and overload, so no overload here for Tessin. Opens up more of his turn next time.
Okay, there is an auction here, but a little bit late. Because now JJ is seriously behind in tempo, so what is he gonna do? I mean, the auction next turn, yes, he will draw some cards, but he's completely behind on in tempo and on board, so... Yeah, I don't really see much benefits.
Yeah, at least the next turn with coin and the auctioneer turn will be into a 3-mana float after the auctioneer.
Yes, yeah.
So
yeah.
You know, and 3-mana opens up a hell of a lot of options actually in Rogue.
Oh
There's a lot of draws you can really make, and combined with the prep, he's gonna have to get a lot of work done with this auctioneer actually next turn. As a second mana tie, it's just gonna keep Tessin's hand looking pretty decent for the while. Not like a huge power play onto the board, but he's got the board with 3 totems. Now Thunderbluff is a very serious threat.
Oh yeah. Especially the Mana Tide also drawing this additional card. Yeah, kind of nice aligned very
yeah, good. This is actually super good.
That's a very, very good draw here. But the Zep doesn't really find targets. Oh, the prep is also insane. Super important. Yeah, the ooze, well, whatever. But yeah, he can play the ooze at least. Oh, whoa.
Oh.
Whoa. Oh, but there is the hex, but he doesn't know. I would just go for a very big admin. I mean, that is what he needs to hope for, right?
Well, we said straight away there needs to be something big happen this turn with this gadget Zan, or he's just going to fall behind in the value game. And I don't know. If you continue to play around hex, then your Edwin Van Cleef's not going to do too much as opposed to potentially winning you the game.
Yeah, I think he doesn't. I think he just throws out Eviscerate on the... I would not even be surprised if he would play it on the Trog. I mean, I would play it on the Totem, but I think JJ's line was consistent. Like last time, he also left the Mana Tide alive. So it seems that JJ prioritizes Mana Tides less than I do. So I'm not surprised about this line, which is completely fine. And then, Edwin went big, but unfortunately, it's a frog.
Does at least soak up some of Tessin's mana next turn. So, you know, it gives JJ a slight way. You know, obviously, if it survived, then yes, you know, the game pretty much ends.
Yeah.
But with the Hex, at least, there's only going to be a 5-mana turn here from Tessin. So he's not going to be able to, you know, too easily build up the board again.
So what is that here? Is it No, it's Maelstrom, right? Yeah, it's Maelstrom. It has to be Maelstrom into Lightning Bolt. There's no way that this is Lightning Storm. Mm-hmm. Maelstrom is doing exactly the same, just better, so why should you not go for that? You can even play another thing from below if you play it like this. Tessen is... well, and that's also the thing. I mean, I was saying, well, maybe Tessen runs out of cards and then Rogue wins because Tessen ran out of cards. But the Mana Tide now drew one card again, so... I don't know what the Trop would have done instead of this Mana Tide, which is...
Yeah, because you have the you're not in any major health issues for the rogue either. Yeah. It's not like you could just die because you've left the minion up that can attack. So yeah, definitely an interesting one. The Ooze getting some value here, picking off the last durability of this Spirit Claw. So not too bad there, and mainly just putting something on the board for JJ. He needs something to be able to start contesting this and putting more pressure onto Tessen.
Oh, it looks very bleak. Yeah, another Mana Tide coming.
No, Totem Golem this time. Why not?
Oh yeah. Sure.
Even the spell power for the Lightning Storm to make this super easy. And now, slightly overloaded for next turn, but Feral Spirit, free thing from below. You know, Feral Spirit for next turn to be even more safe, and this is just getting worse and worse for JJ. Sap and Conceal in hand. Gadgetzan, maybe the only card that could have, continued this game.
Yes.
I guess. So the Sap onto the thing from below for the second time. So it's both Saps use this game to push that 5-5 back into Tessen's hand. And I guess Conceal, since the Drake is not going to do too much this turn.
It's interesting, but it's, I would say, not even that will save JJ. But speaking of the value game, it's really interesting because now it might have been that that he would have won there. But yeah, let's just take a look at it. The thing from below zero. Okay. Because, I mean, Tessen is effectively out of cards, right? Nearly. Mm. So
it's very close, yeah. But he has Flame Tongue, so which is insane value for after the Gadgetzan comes out of stealth anyway. You can continue to just trade away any minions that Super JJ may have left, or just straight up push for damage. These Feral Spirits are going to be a pain.
I like it.
I like putting the Feral Spirits in now because the thing from below is always going to be easy to play.
Yeah. I like this too.
Okay, so JJ probably wants a spell of some kind. Doesn't get it.
Oh, that's so secret. You don't... Oh, okay. Yeah, that's probably gonna do
so
it.
He's just dead, right? Oh, he's two off with the trade.
Yeah.
Contestant draw the damage.
No, but lightning.
It's only a matter of time. Yeah, spell power lightning storm is kind of nuts.
Yeah, I guess so.
Oh, there you go. I think that's the concede from JJ. They can't come back after that lightning storm clearing up the board and Tessen. Beating JJ again 3-1 and continues his just stomp through this tournament.
Hmm. Yeah, very interesting, especially because we will now see Tessen in the grand finals. Mm. And not only, and this is interesting, it's not an equalized finals because the one player coming from the lower bracket will need to win two times as much as I am informed.
Yep,
so that
that's
means
correct.
Tessen needs to win one out of the next two matches and then he will be the tournament winner. So he has like an insane win percentage to win the tournament here.
Yeah, I mean, like, and to be fair, you know, as you mentioned earlier, Nimsh, and welcome back, of course, like Tessen has gone through this whole tournament and not dropped a series. And you know what? This is like true double LM as opposed to some other tournaments that don't run it, where there is a winner's advantage. And you know what? There should be. If you've not dropped a series all tournament, then you kind of deserve something, right?
I do agree. And RDU called it a huge advantage. And as I've mentioned, Tessen goes to that final. As you said, he has two chances, and not only normal two chances, but he can adjust his strategy if he loses. If he's like, he has this winning strategy, he loses, he's like, all right, I guess that didn't work. Let's try again with something absolutely different.
Wait, there are two pick and ban phases?
Yeah, awesome. the two completely separate series, yeah.
Awesome. Oh.
Yeah, it's going to be good. It's going to be good. But we do see some of the highlights from this series. And we see JJ got off to a really good start. He, you know, almost like won the initial pick, I would say. Going Hunter straight into Murloc Power, then you can't feel any better here with the lineups available to each player. But now we see Tessen start to fight back. And I think this was the beginning of the end, I feel, for JJ. This is a match that, as you said, JJ picked Freeze Mage into it because you feel super comfortable. But, you know, we can see that it wasn't quite good enough with JJ just struggling to finish up the game, and you know, pretty much on the back of the Tuskars, like, you know, let's be honest, the Manatide never dying, and drawing approximately 1 million cards really helped out Tessin there.
It shows the power of the Shaman of War, and the Spirit Claws also did a lot of work in those matchups, I think, from the Shaman's perspective. So. Really well played overall. Was there anything specific in this match that you like, guys like?
I think it was just Tessin being able to put up such continued pressure that JJ never had the opportunity to move forward with his plan to actually win the game. He was always on the defensive from very early on, and that's what can happen versus Freeze Mage sometimes. It's all about just getting to your win condition very quickly and being able to start the game long enough to do that, and you just couldn't quite do both.
Right, and here Tasker Totemic with the thing from below with that storm, a very big turn for Tessin. Normally Rogue right now has trouble just dealing with so many minions. Fan of Knives is the only AoE card. He can maybe buff it with that spell damage, but no big flurry. It's hard to deal with all that. And at the end, even JJ not picking the spells, Shadow Strike coming too late. And Tessin is actually with us right now. So Tessin, congratulations, you are in the grand final.
Thanks a lot. I'm for sure really happy about it and looking forward to see who I'm gonna face.
Who do you want to face? Do you want to face JJ again?
I don't
want to
face Hoi. That's like the point. Like, I beat it the wrist, and like, I remember Hoi throw me out at DreamHack Winter. So yeah, he's for sure not a guy I want to face. But like, revenge is always good, right? And this tournament is going pretty good for me so far. So
yeah, I'd say that again. Undefeated. No, it's normally a good sign.
So did you have like any specific strategy coming into this tournament, or is like some people that helped you a lot? Like, do you want to give a shout out to them right now?
Yeah, like for sure about all the strategy. I mostly figured a lot of stuff out myself, and Sixu was for sure the guy who's doing the most. Like, spoke with him about strategy and ban order, and like on the tournament itself, I spoke a lot with Kirst about how do I choose the bans, because I believe bans is everything. Like. For sure, you know how to play Hearthstone. We all do that here. Like, people are good. But you just want to have as high chance of winning as possible. And I believe the bans is doing most. So, yeah.
So would you like to see more tournaments like this with nine classes and ban pick?
For sure. Like, this tournament is so hardcore. You really have the opportunity to show that if you're a good player. So, yeah, I would like to see more of this. And I would for sure play them all.
All right. And the guys, do you have more questions to Tessin?
No, I think we covered everything.
What did you give your Tuskas to eat this morning?
Yeah, I thought like the best way to beat a Freeze Mage is outvalue them, so I just went for the card draw strategy by getting Manatide.
That's awesome.
The strategy makes of sense. Getting Manatide from Tuskar.
Yeah, it worked out
pretty good. Yeah, reasonable.
Makes sense. All right, congratulations again. And now we'll have another match ready for you guys. Give us some time to prepare the players, and we'll be back after a break.